Good day, my dear students. How are you all doing? I hope you're doing great. And I hope you're keeping safe during this corona period. I just want you guys to understand that everything happening right now would at some point in time fizzle all the way. Right now it might look like things are not fine with the world, but just want to assure us that things will get better. I'm sure we'll see the end of this corona period. This corona period will not see the end of us. So, on a general note, but I hope you guys are keeping and doing good. Just keep following the guidelines as prescribed by the health experts. I believe things will be fine. Now, having said that, we'll be starting our lecture proper as regards ECHO 212, that is the history of economic thought. Now, when we make mention of the history of economic thought, it's something that it's one course that every student of economics should be eager to want to learn about, because the history of economic thought gives you a broader understanding. It gives you a much more perfect understanding of how the economic thoughts have evolved over time. That is how one thought has evolved over time, as time went by. The history of economic thought would help you understand better the minds, the ideas of great economic scholars. So it's always a course that every student of economics should be delighted to want to, you know, be part of. And it's against this backdrop that we'll be introducing this course, the history of economic thought, for the first time. It's going to be in two semesters. This is history of economic thought one. Come next semester, we're also going to be having the history of economic thought two. And I'm also sure by now you guys must have downloaded the materials from the MyCCU platform, the course guide, and then the previous slides that have been uploaded already. I'm sure by now you guys must have downloaded that, and we must have gone through it. We must have an idea of what we're going to be starting with and how this course is going to go. But please, if there is any part of it you're not clear with, please, I'm always available to listen to your questions and prefer answer as much as I can. Please feel free to always contact me. Any question at all, any time of the day, my email ID is here, as you can see on this front page. It's gideon.okk@ccu.edu.ng. And of course, you guys have my phone number and my WhatsApp account. Whichever way you feel much more. If you are even much more comfortable with the MyCCU platform, very wonderful. You could reach me out there. I would always be there to answer instantly. Now, having said that, now let's move into the topic for the day. Today we're going to be making a general introduction on what the history of economic thought is all about. And then come next class, we're going to start looking at various schools of thought. So today, at the end of this session, you should be able to explain what history of economic thought is all about. You should be able to explain how some economic thought has evolved over time. And you should be able to highlight the standard organization of economic writings. That is, how economic writings are organized. From various scholars down to the next scholar, or from various schools of thought down to the next school of thought, depending on what approach you're going to be looking at. Now, when we talk of history of economic thought, there are various definitions. There are numerous definitions of the history of economic thought that have been given. As you can see on your screen right now, there are numerous definition that have been given by different scholars. According to H.L. Bardia, he saw history of economic thought that it includes the doctrines and the generalization of various thinkers, which deals with the economic phenomena of our life. He saw it as a structure that includes the doctrine of various thinkers, various economic thinkers, like the likes of Adam Smith, the likes of David Ricardo, the likes of Schumpeter, the likes of Stanley Givens, and so on. He saw it as a doctrine or a generalization of these various thinkers' ideas. Why Professor Schumpeter saw history of economic thought as the sum total of all the opinions and desires concerning economic subjects, especially with public policies. Take note of that. He said that history of economic thought is the sum total of all the opinions and desires. Professor Hani here saw it as a critical account of the development of economic ideas. You can see this is quite striking. He says that it's a critical account. As we are going to continue, you're going to be seeing various criticisms of different schools of thought. You would see the criticisms of somebody like John Maynard Keynes, his criticisms of the classicalists and their ideas, how he criticized the Say's law of market. We are going to come to all this. So don't begin to say which one is Say's law of market again, which one is a classicalist, which one is this one, which one is that one. Don't worry, we are going to take them one after the other. Professor Bernier saw the history of economic thought as the study of the heritage that is left by the writers of economic subjects. That is, as the study of the heritage that has been left by economic writers. Now, there's something we must be very careful about while studying the history of economic thought. Please take note. History of economic thought is not the same thing as economic history. Neither is it the same thing as history of economics. History of economic thought mainly focuses on how economic thought has evolved over time, beginning from the classicalist, even before the classicalist, down. We're going to be looking at the likes of the Greek philosophical thoughts. Greek economic thoughts. We're going to be looking at the Hebrew economic thoughts. We're going to be looking at the Oriental economic thoughts. Before we now come over to the classicalist, and then down to the marginalist, and so on and so forth, till we get to contemporary economists. So the history of economic thought mainly focuses on how all these thoughts have evolved over time. While economic history looks at what the history of economies of the world. It looks at what the history of different economies. Like we could say, okay, the history of Nigerian economy, the history of Indian economy, the history of American economy, and so on. Take note, please. The history of economic thought focuses on how these thoughts have evolved over time, while economic history looks at what the history of various economies. These are two different ideas. Now, the next thing you're going to be looking at is the significance or the importance. Why do we need to study the history of economic thought? Why do we have to? The first one is that the study of the history of economic thought clearly shows that there is certain unity in economic thought. It shows that that most of all these economic thoughts are interconnected. The ideas of the Orientals, the ideas of the Bullionists, the ideas of the physiocrats, the ideas of the classicalists, of the marginalists, and so on, of the neo-Keynesian, of the Keynesian school of thought, all these, they are some form of convergence. There's some connection between them. So the history of economic thought helps you to understand these connections. Also, the history of economic thought helps you understand the mistakes of previous economic thinkers. Take, for example, the classicalist, for example. Before the Great Depression of the 1930s, They were of the opinion that the economy is being controlled by an invisible hand, and that the economy is always at full equilibrium, and that the invisible hand is what controls, is the mechanism that controls what economy, and as such, there is nothing like what, like this equilibrium. And even after there is this equilibrium at some point, that invisible hand will always restore the economy back to equilibrium. But during the 1930s, that particular idea became clearly something that was a flaw. It was an error, so to say, because the global depression of 1930 proved that the economy does not what self-regulate itself, and that the invisible hand at times is not just even enough to control the economy, and there is need for government intervention. Unlike what the classicalists believe, that there should be no government intervention, it should be a laissez-faire economy, a free economy. So the Great Depression pointed out to them that there is need for government intervention. So you can see, the history of economic talk will help you understand the mistakes that have been made by past thinkers, and as such, you will not make the same mistake. Also, the history of economic thought is an important tool of knowledge. The study of history of economic thought helps students to realize that economics is different from what, from economists. These are two different things: an economy and economics. Economics is a subject. Economics is somebody that does what an economy does, an economist does. That is, if we will go by the definition of what's it called, this great thinker. He said, an economist is a person who does what an economist does. Now, the next thing is that the history of economics does help students to know the economic idea, to know that economic ideas are conditioned by time, places, and circumstances, which is very true. What might be obtainable in this economy might not be obtainable in another economy. What might work in an American economy might not work in a Nigerian economy. So, the history of economic thought will help you understand things that works at different points in time. Also, the history of economic thought helps you to know economic thinkers responsible for the formulation of certain principles. Like, it helps you to understand which economic thinker, which economist brought out a particular idea. Take, for example, we'll talk of the sales law of market that says that supply creates its own demand. It helps you understand that this principle was brought about by J.B. Say, John Baptist Say. When we talk of the idea of the invisible hand, concepts like division of labor, specialization, and so on, these are the brainchild of somebody like Adam Smith. When we talk of ideas like the theory of general equilibrium, we are looking at the life of the war and your world. We are looking at ideas like just name them, different ideas, different concepts, how they were propounded and who propounded them. Also, the study of the history of economic thought will help you to understand the origin of economics as a discipline, how it evolved, how it came about from political economy and so on. Also, the study will help students to know that economic ideas have been instrumental into shaping economic and political policies of different countries of the world. These economic ideas that we are going to be looking at by different schools of thought, a history of economic thought will help you understand how these ideas have shaped economic and political spaces. Also, the study of the history of economic thought will provide a broad basis for comparison of economic ideas. When you have to compare the ideas of the classicalists with that of the neoclassicalists, with that of the Keynesian school of thought, you can only compare them when you've already understood them in the first place. Another thing is that the history of economy helps you gain a broader perspective on problems and issues. It's only when you've understood how These thoughts have evolved over time. It is only then that you can profess solutions to problems and issues facing contemporary economy. So you can see that the history of economic thought is extremely very, very important for economists, for policymakers, and of course for students of economics. Now the next thing we're going to be looking at are the ways we can study the history of economic thought. The numerous ways, but I've outlined 9 of them here. The first one is the deductive or the classical approach. The second one is the inductive approach. The third is the chronological approach. The fourth is the conceptual approach. Fifth is the philosophical approach. The sixth is the neoclassical approach. The seventh is the welfare approach. The eighth is the Keynesian approach. And the ninth is the institutional approach. And we're going to take them one after the other, beginning with the deductive approach. Now, when we talk of the deductive approach simply has to do with moving from what? From the top down to what? Down. Now, take for example, if I come up with something, with an hypothesis, and I say, all birds have wings. That is my first premise. It's a general assumption. It's a general hypothesis. Now, if I say eagles are birds, that is the second premise. Now, since I've said in the first place that all birds have wings, and now I said eagles are birds, it automatically means that what? Eagles are what? Birds that have what? Wings. I hope that makes sense. So when we say, when we talk of deductive approach, the deductive approach simply has to do with what? Being able to deduce out of a general sense, being able to deduce something out of it. Let's take for example, an hypothesis or a theory has been put forth. You being able to deduce from it. Are we following? So that is what the deductive or the classical reasoning approach is all about. A general idea or a general hypothesis or a general theory has been given. From that, you're able to deduce, just like we have here. We said all birds have wings. And then I tell you about that eagles are birds. You don't need a soothsayer to tell you that if eagles are birds and all birds have wings, automatically eagles have wings. That should be your conclusion. Now, the second thing we're going to be looking at is the inductive reasoning approach. Now, this is the opposite of the inductive. In the case of the deductive, we could also call it the top-down bottom, because you are starting from the top downwards. But in the case of the inductive, it is called the bottom-up approach. You're moving from what? From a less complex idea to a much more complex idea. Are we following? So the inductive approach or the inductive reasoning, under this one, we begin with specific observations. And then we begin to detect patterns and regularities. And based on these, we formulate an hypothesis. Whereas in the case of the other one, we first of all formulate hypothesis, and then based on that hypothesis, we reach out to a conclusion. But in the case of this one, we make specific observations before we use that to form what? Before we use it to form or formulate an hypothesis. Now the next one is abductive reasoning. The abductive reasoning is a combination of the inductive and what? And the deductive. It was introduced by the popular philosopher Charles Peirce. Under it, we combine both what the inductive and the deductive approach. The next one is the chronological. When we talk of chronological approach, It has to do with what? Making use of time. Beginning from what, from a particular point in time. Let's say, for example, we decide to talk about the economic thoughts from what, let's say, 2000 BC, and then downwards, you're tracing it down, 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 coming from AD down to BC, down to what, the 90s, down to what, 2000s, that we find ourselves. That is chronological, according to what, according to time. Now, the next one is the what, is the conceptual approach. This approach speaks about the evaluation of different economic concepts. It's what speaks about what different economic what concepts. And then the next one is the philosophical approach. The philosophical approach is one approach that was mostly adopted by what, by the great thinker Plato. And when we begin to consider the Greek philosophical thought, I mean the Greek economic thought, would shed more light on this. And then of course we have the neoclassical, which was mostly adopted by great thinkers like Alfred Marshall. And then we have the welfare approach, which aims at providing what the basis for adopting policies which are likely to maximize social welfare. And then we have the institutional approach. Institutional approach mostly questions the validity of classical ideas. When we begin to look at the classical ideas and so on, you understand, I believe you understand better. And of course, we have what? The Keynesian approach. The Keynesian approach, sorry. The Keynesian approach is mainly based upon the works of John Maynard Keynes. And this approach is still a little bit new when compared to the classicalist school. And it takes into consideration the operations of business circles and how this affects economic policies. So now, having looked at this, the next thing you're going to be looking at is standard organization of economic writing. Standard organization of economic. So we're going to be looking at the standard economic writing. Now, when we talk of the standard economic writing, it simply has to do with how economic thoughts are organized, from where to where. Are we following? From what point to what point? How we organize this for easy understanding. Now, the first set of writings that we consider under the history of economic thought are the early pre-classicalists, which passed between 800 BC to 1500 BC. Under this class of writings, we're going to be looking at what the Hebrew classical thoughts, I mean the Hebrew economic thoughts, the Chinese, that is the Guangzi, the Hesiod, Xenophon, this we're talking of the Greeks, Aristotle, Plato, and so on. And then the Arabians, and of course, the scholastics. So we are going to be looking at all these. And then the next one is the pre-classicalist themselves. And under this, we're looking at the mercantilist. Don't worry, you might be looking a little bit wavy, right? And you're asking yourself, what is all this? Don't worry. By the time we begin to move into each and any one of these schools, you begin to enjoy this course. Mercantilist. And under the mercantilist, we have the likes of great thinkers such as Moon, Petty, Mandeville, Hume, Cantillon. And then we have the physiocrats. These are a group of French economic thinkers. And their chief proponent was Quisling. And the next one we're going to be looking at is what the next standard of writing is what is the classicalist proper. And those that belong to this school of thought are the likes of Adam Smith, David Ricardo, John Baptist Say, Thomas Malthus, Babbage, Mills, that is J.S. Mill, John Stuart Mills, Marx, and so on and so forth. And then we're going to look at the neoclassicalists. And these are The likes of Stanley Gibbons, Carl Menger, Leon Worrell, Witzel, Clark, Fisher, Marshall, Higgs, Samuelson. I mean, Alfred Marshall is very prominent in this school of thought. And then we'll be looking at the next standard economic writing is the institutionalist, known as the likes of Milton Friedman, Hayek, John Maynard Keynes, Kim Peter, Galbraith, the Austrian school, and then the post-Keynesian school. So, I would just want to wrap up this very session by saying that you are in for a very wonderful experience. I mean, it's usually very wonderful getting the opportunity to trace the origin of the history of the great minds, look at how great economic thought has evolved over time, and, you know, learning one or two from these great minds and trying to apply them, see how best they fit in contemporary society. So, I mean, it's something, I don't know, I feel thrilled already about it. And I'm sure you are going to be in for it. So please, once more, I want to believe you've gathered, you've downloaded the materials from my CCU space. If you have not, please do that. I've uploaded our lecture material for the next two classes. So please get those materials, begin to study them. Reference, I've also sent you across the recommended textbook for this course. Go through it. We're going to be beginning with, like we have here, the early classical. We're going to start in our next class. We're going to be looking at the Hebrew and the Chinese school of thought. So please, history of economic thought is much more interesting when you've already read through some of these things. And then when we come together, we just discuss them. We share ideas together. It becomes much more fun. So I would encourage you to please go through those materials, study them, come with questions, come with intentions of this course, so that it will be an enriching experience for both you and for me. Thank you very much on this session. Once more, if you have any question on this, please, my handles are there. Reach me through any of those platforms, my email, my WhatsApp. You could call me, even put a call across, that's always welcome, anytime, any day. Your questions are always welcome. Thank you. We will meet again next week. God bless you. And please endeavor to keep safe until this period comes and goes. I assure you that it will all end in praise. Thank you very much, and bye for now.